Welcome back to a brand new TV show review here on Max Talks Movies. My name is Max Sennenberg, and today I am breaking down season two, episode five of Loki, called Science Fiction. We're going to break down the episode, give mostly my general thoughts on the episode and where we're going to be for the finale next week. So welcome back to the channel. If you're new to the channel, please subscribe, ring the bell. I do movie reviews, TV show reviews, movie rankings, and every Monday, I do a box office breakdown show where I break down the box office. So please subscribe, ring the bell if you're new to the channel. Comment down below. What are your thoughts on this new episode of Loki? Was this filler to you? Was this a good setup for the finale? Did you like it? Did you not like it? I love having these fun discussions with you guys as of late. The comment section has been so much fun for me to chat with you guys a lot. So let's keep chatting down in the comment section down below. And also, please like the video, the thumbs up button. That's how you support this channel. Helps the algorithm out on YouTube. So if you hit that like button, more people will come to the channel and discover what we're doing here at Max Talks Movies. So let's get into Loki season two, episode five. I really enjoyed this episode. This is definitely not my favorite episode of the season, but this is another just great episode of the series. And I'm just thoroughly enjoying the direction that the show is going to. And so this episode was basically, we saw the big cliffhanger and ending last week, where would we go next? And basically it was Loki trying to basically recruit all the people, all of his friends who are now back on the timeline, recruit them back to the TVA, help them stop, He Who Remains Kang. And we got to see all of these characters in their own timeline. So we see Mobius or Don back at the, jet ski place, having a single being a single dad, having two kids. We see B-15's is like pediatrician in her really nice scene. Sylvie's back working at McDonald's. You had like I forgot his name on the show. But Eugene Cordero's character, Casey, sorry, Casey, he's like escaping Alcatraz. And then you have OB, who is this failed writer who writes science fiction, but also his day job as a scientist. I really enjoyed this and Loki recruiting them and talking to them. And I kept thinking to myself the whole set this episode, this is probably what Kang wants. Because yes, all these people were a part of the TVA, but maybe secretly Loki is the one who brought them to the TVA. I find this to be really interesting. The timeline logic is not confusing to me. Especially towards the end of the episode, the time slipping, that all makes sense, but maybe there's a destiny to this time slipping and the time stuff. And maybe this is what Kang wants Loki to do, which I find really fascinating. So we go throughout. OB for me is like the MVP of this episode. He's so funny. And again, I've been saying this to people a lot who've watched the show. I just love Ke-Huy Quan in the show. He's fantastic in the show. And there's obviously a great mixture of nostalgia for me for him, obviously with Indiana Jones. I'm such a big Indiana Jones fan and Goonies. But he's also a terrific actor and he's terrific in the show. But he does have that childish humor that he had in the 1980s that I just really enjoy him bringing back with both Everything Everywhere All at Once and this. It's just this childish, innocent humor that he brings. And it's so easy just to want to root for him. The fact when we get revealed that he's the one who's putting his own books into this library, really funny scene. And then when Loki hands him the book and he's like, I must be a bestseller then, if this is on everyone's desk. I really enjoy his comedy and I really enjoy his performance. But I mean, the best part of the episode was the emotional core of the episode, which obviously comes with all these people sacrificing things to join Loki. But it's the sit down at the bar with Loki and Sylvie. Again, Sylvie gets some great scenes in this season. But this is really all about Loki, which is that Loki, out of all the people, Sylvie does remember. She's not just back on a timeline. She remembers everything that happened and she's cool with it. She's back at her place. She's working at McDonald's. She's in a happy spot. And Loki says, we need to hire everyone back and get everyone back to have the TVA. And she says, what are you going to do? Again, pull them out of their lives without a choice again, like he did. And she says, what I want is just to live my life. And she's like, what do you want? He kept saying, save the TVA, stop you. He said, that's not who it is. And he says he wants his friends back because he says he's lonely. And he basically comes out to say, and she was like, no, they all have their place on the timeline now. And he says, without them, where do I fit in? Where do I belong? And that's when she says, we all have to write our own stories now. A powerful scene between that's so well acted by both Sophie DiMartino and obviously Sophia DiMartino and obviously by Tom Hiddleston. Just so well acted. The dialogue was really great. And you felt the sadness in Loki. Now, yes, he's doing it for selfish reasons, getting his friends back so he's not lonely. It is a selfish thing to do, but Loki does not know where he fits into the world without having Mobius and B-15 and Casey and Sylvie in his life. And I found that to be very interesting. Because he grew up hating where he was, didn't really care about his, obviously, he didn't had his disdain for Thor. And this is Avengers Loki, not even Thor the Dark World. So it doesn't really want Odin, doesn't really like Odin at this point because Odin's the one who gave Thor the kingship in Asgard. So this is really where he finally found his place. And I think a lot of people this touched a chord with, because a lot of us, even with having friends, don't know where we fit in the world. And I found this to be a really moving scene that even a god can say, where does he doesn't know where he belongs. And I really found it to be a very moving scene. So we cut back towards the end of the episode, and everything's falling apart in Sylvie's world. Sylvie luckily has a temp pad. Loki's like done. She's like, I'm gonna send everyone back. Everyone's happy. It's all about me. Honestly, I said, and Sylvie says, you can't send them back just yet. Our worlds are crumbling. And then everyone spaghettied in this one scene. It's really heartbreaking. Like, what is going on? And then Loki finally controls his time slip. It's not how, it's not why, it is who. And that's how he's controlling his time slipping. So he time slips back to the original moment, and Loki, tells Obi, I finally cracked the code on time slipping. And then we cut to the final shot of the episode, is him going back to the TVA right before the moment that Victor Timely gets spaghettied to avoid the whole thing of happening. So I am very excited to see where the show ends. Now, again, a lot of stuff has been going on wrong at the moment with from article perspective from Marvel. You have Variety, have a reporter posting all of these stories about the state of Marvel Studios and what they've been doing and their plans moving forward. And one of those has been the fact that they might move off of Kang and move Doctor Doom as the main villain for the next Avengers movies. I'm very interested to see. They said they had not cut any of the Kang scenes. This show might be deemed meaningless in years to come if Kang is not the villain we move forward with in the MCU. And I feel like we can only end this show with Kang coming out on top somehow, because we know Kang will be the ultimate, as of now, the ultimate villain of the MCU. Now, still, there's heavy rumors and speculation, especially some Variety articles saying that they are talks of Doom, of them moving off of Kang, but talks and actually doing it are big differences. So the Jonathan Majors case is very much in flux right now. A lot of things are going on. He just got, I think, like a London situation happened there. So it seems like we have a long way to go if we're going to deem Majors in court innocent or guilty, and what Marvel can truly do moving forward. But because this is taking so long, and Marvel has, they're not going to hold up every single project until this case is over, they have to have a plan. So next week's episode will be really interesting, because even in Ant-Man and the Wasp: Quantumania, that version of Kang died, but we still ended with all those Kangs in the first mid-credit scene. So it'll be interesting to see what they do with Kang at the end of this show and what they do with these characters after this show. If Kang is no longer in the show, will there be a Loki season three? Where will they do, what will they do with these characters after this show? If this ends on a dark note with Kang being on top, there are some really interesting things going on here, and I'm very fascinated as we have one episode left. So thanks for joining me on this breakdown of Loki. Every single Friday, and it will conclude next Friday with reviews of Loki, and also starting out every Saturday for the first 2 weeks, but then back to Fridays will be my Invincible reviews on Amazon Prime. So stay tuned tomorrow for my review of Invincible season two starting. So please subscribe, ring the bell, and I'll see you guys soon.